All right. Welcome to the DDPS seminar, everyone. Before we introduce our invited speaker, let's go over some rules as usual. First of all, please mute yourself during the talk. If you have immediate questions, you're welcome to unmute and ask. Otherwise, please use the chat room to post your questions so that we will address them in the Q&A session at the end. Second, today's seminar is open to external audience, so no classified discussion is allowed. Finally, the talk will be recorded and uploaded to our YouTube channel. Now, please let me introduce our speaker. It is an honor to host Professor Lu Lu, who is currently an assistant professor in the Department of Statistics and Data Science at Yale University. Before joining Yale, he was an assistant professor in the Department of Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering at the University of Pennsylvania from 2021 to 2023, and an applied mathematics instructor in the Department of Mathematics at MIT from 2020 to 2021. In 2020, he obtained his PhD degree in applied mathematics, master degrees in engineering, applied mathematics, and computer science at Brown University, while he received his bachelor degrees in mechanical engineering, economics, and computer science at Tsinghua University in 2013. His current research lies in scientific machine learning, including theory, algorithms, and software, and its applications to engineering, physical, and biological problems. His broad research interests focus on multiscale modeling and high-performance computing for physical and biological systems. He has received the 2022 DOE Early Career Award and 2020 Joukowsky Family Foundation Outstanding Dissertation Award of Brown University. Today, he will talk about deep neural operators with reliable extrapolation for multiphysics, multiscale, and multifidelity problems. Please enjoy the wonderful talk. Now, without further ado, let me hand it over to Lu.
Yeah, thank you for the nice introduction. So in this talk, from the title, you may see that I will mainly discuss our recent works of deep neural operators. So I will not go to too much the background introduction, but let me just give you one page brief background showing here. So usually when we consider deep neural networks, we try to use a neural network to learn a mapping of functions. So from one finite dimension of D1 to another finite dimension D2. So this is the accuracy or the approximation error is guaranteed by the universal approximation theorem for functions, which was proved long time ago in 1989. So along this line, many different methods have been developed, or many different algorithms have been developed to achieve good accuracy. For example, for image classification, the input is the image, could be 20 by 20 pixels, which is 400 dimensions. Then the output is a scalar or vector. Also, the development of physics informed networks, which is also used to learn the solution, usually the single solution of a PDE, which is still a function of mapping. But in this talk, I will go beyond the standard function learning to operator learning. So the operator here I referred is a mapping from one function to another function. So instead of from one finite dimension vector to another vector. So one simple case in calculus of the operator is a derivative operator. So if our input is xt, then our output is the derivative of xt, x prime t. So this is one simple operator. Or we can also consider another simple operator, the integral. For input xt, then we will compute the integral of xt with respect to a kernel k. This also maps from one function to another function. But in this talk, I will mainly consider the system of PDEs or ODEs. Then the input could be the boundary condition, initial condition, or forcing terms of the PDE. Then output will be the solutions of the PDE. But more broadly, this kind of framework can be applied to other systems, biological system, or even social system. So when we go from function learning to operator learning, then a direct question is, whether we can still learn operators by using neural networks. So at first, whether this exists a similar theory of universal approximation theory for functions, but in the operator setup. So let me first introduce a few notations here, which we also used in this talk. The operator we will learn is denoted by this script G. Then the input function is denoted by U. Then the output is another function, which is GU. So GU and GU are both functions. As GU is a function, then let's consider Y is a single location or a point in the domain of GU. Then GUY is the value of function GU evaluated at this specific location Y. Then the answer to my previous question actually is true. So as shown in this theory here, so we can prove that the neural networks, so actually it's very powerful to approximate nonlinear operators, but definitely giving some assumptions. So the main assumption is that the space should be compact and the operator G should be continuous. So given these two main assumptions, then the theorem in this paper shows that for arbitrary operator G and arbitrary input function U and location Y, there always exists a neural network in this form such that the error between the ground truth operator G and the prediction from the neural network can be arbitrarily small than any epsilon. So basically, this is a one extension of the standard approximation theorem of functions, of neural networks for functions extended to operators. So I will not go into details into the theory part, and in this talk, I will mainly consider the methodology. How can we implement the neural network to achieve a good accuracy and efficiency? So when we try to design a network, a neural network, to learn the output GU from input U, then if we consider our network is still a black box, let's first look at what's the inputs and outputs of the network. So first, our input must have the input function U. So U is one input. However, the function U is in the infinite dimension space. We cannot directly input this function into this neural network. A neural network in our computers can only take a finite dimension input. So this the first step is convert the infinite dimension space function U to a finite dimension vector. There are different ways to do this, and in this picture here, I just show you one simple way. Let's consider we have a dense mesh of or dense locations of x1, x2, and until xm in the location of the domain of U. Then the values of function U in these locations, ux1, ux2, until uxm, can be used to represent the input function U if these locations are dense enough. So this is the finite dimension approximation of the input. Then this can be used as a network input. Similarly, for the output of the network, still we try to predict a function GU instead of a finite dimensional vector. We can do a similar trick that we only predict the function U at a finite scattered locations. However, in this talk, we try to avoid any kind of discretization for the output function U. So the way we do this is as follows. So in addition to the input function U, we also have another input of the location Y. Then given the input function U and Y, the output would be the function GU evaluated at this location Y. This is kind of similar to the physics informed neural networks. So in physics informed neural networks or pins, the input is the coordinates. The output is the function value at this specific coordinate. We do similar thing here. Y is a coordinate. The output is this function GU at this specific coordinate Y. But this function depends on the input, and other function depends on the input function. So this approach would be mesh-free and also discretization-free. It can be used to unstructured and arbitrary data locations. So this is one advantage. Another advantage is that when we consider PDEs, if you try to compute the derivatives of the other function GEO with respect to the Y, then by using this approach here, the derivative can be directly computed by using automatic differentiation, the same as pings. So this is no discretization error. So this is inputs and outputs of the neural network. Now let's look at the network architecture. So we could apply any network architecture to this kind of setup. But because here we have two inputs, so we consider split the entire network into two components. On the top, we have one network, branch net, takes U as input and outputs a hidden vector. And at bottom here, we have another network, the trunk net, takes Y as input and outputs another hidden vector. Then we compute the final output, the GUY, as a dot product between these two vectors, or as shown in the equation here. So the basic idea is that the GUY is a function of U, however, is conditioning on, is function of Y, but conditioning on U. Then in this formula here, the TKY can be viewed as the basis function of Y, and the BKU basically the coefficients, but depends on the U. So in DeepM&Mnet, we use the trunk net to learn what's the optimal basis function for this specific PDE. Then branch net learns what's the coefficients in front of the basis function for arbitrary input. So this is a simple test case, a Darcy problem in a triangle domain with a notch. So the PDE is simple, but in this problem, the geometry is complex, as shown in the picture here. So we try to predict the solution of this PDE from the boundary conditions. And after training, this is a one test case of the prediction. So we have ground truth and the prediction of DeepM&Mnet. And from the error here, you can see it's roughly 1 or 2%. So this is the first version or vanilla version of DeepM&Mnet. But after our first work, we have developed many different extensions of DeepM&Mnet in order to improve the accuracy or improve the efficiency or extend the capability to diverse scenarios. So as I mentioned, for the branch net, we have input function U. We need to convert the input function U to a finite dimension approximation or representation. We could apply the evaluation as we looked at it before, or we could project the input function V into a basis function. Then we can use the coefficients of the basis function as the discretization. Also, another extension we have developed is called POD-DeepONet. And so as I mentioned, so the branch net is used to learn what's the optimal basis function. However, in scientific computing, there are many good methods to compute the basis function. So one simple but good but efficient method is called POD, proper orthogonal decomposition. Then we can first compute the POD modes from the training data set. Then for the trunk network, in addition to a standard network, we also apply the pre-computed basis from POD. So this is a hybrid method of the neural network and the standard traditional numerical methods by using POD. So by doing this, so first of all, instead of learning everything from scratch by using network, we have a good starting point of the POD modes. And also, so this will be increase our training efficiency. And also at the end, we can also achieve higher accuracy. So this is the same problem, the Darcy problem. And in the last column here, we show the performance of the POD DeepM&Mnet. So compared to the standard DeepM&Mnet, by using the POD Bayesian function, we can achieve even a better accuracy. So this is the standard DeepM&Mnet and the extension by using POD. But in all these two examples, as we can see, we only consider a single input operator. So which means our input function is just a single function. In the previous example, it's a boundary condition. And also in the theory I have showed, the theory can only apply it to the input, to a single function input. But in general, or in many cases, we try to predict the PD solutions for different initial condition, boundary condition, or forcing terms simultaneously. So which means our input is not a single input, but it is a multiple input operator. So specifically, let's consider our input spaces in total have n binary spaces, x1, x2, until xn. Or equivalently, we have n input functions, v1, v2, and until vn. Now we try to have a neural network takes all these n functions as input and outputs the corresponding output function, for example, PDE solution. So before we go to the implementation, first step, we should always prove that the neural network is still universal approximator in this scenario. So this is what we showed in the paper shown here. So actually, the neural network can also be used to approximate multiple input operators. So without getting into too much details, the key idea when we prove the theorem is as follows. So we construct the neural network by showing this equation here. So in addition to a single branch net, we consider we have internal n branch nets. Then each branch net takes one function as input. Then these n outputs, n vectors, will become an n dimension tensor. Then for the trial network, instead of outputting a one dimension vector, it will output another n dimension tensor. Then we compute the tensor-tensor product to compute the corresponding output. So this is okay for the proof, but this tensor product is too expensive in practice. Then we can further apply a low rank tensor approximation to reduce the cost. So for the trial net, instead of predict a high dimension tensor, we also output a one dimension vector. Then we have internal n plus one vectors. Then we compute the element wise product of all these vectors, then compute sum of all the elements in the vector. So this is architecture of the network we call MIONet. It can be viewed as a straightforward extension of DeepM&Mnet from a single binary space, from a single branch net to n branch nets. A simple test case shown here is a dimension diffusion equation. So we try to predict this solution U from different initial condition U0 and also different diffusion coefficients. And here we assume the diffusion coefficients is also a space dependent. So this is one test case after the training, so it can achieve a small error. So this confirms the MIONet is indeed a universal approximator. Then we have further applied this kind of idea to more realistic problems instead of the previous two simple cases. So one application we tested is in the geoscience, geologic carbon sequestration. So in this application, so we inject the CO2 into the underground. Then what we try to do is predict what's the saturation, what's the pressure of the CO2 in the following 30 years. So this problem can be modeled by the multiphase flow in the porous media. So this is the equation shown here and the loss of variables. So from this equation, in order to solve it by using traditional numerical methods, the challenge is that it is too expensive. So first of all, this problem is multiphysics and multiscale. And also, we try to solve this problem in a really large domain. So in a large spatial scale and also a large temporal scale. So for the spatial scale, we consider it from a few hundred meters, from 10 meters to 200 meters by a million meters. So a millimeter is the length and 200 meters is the depth. And as mentioned, we try to predict the solution of the PDE for 30 years. So they're too expensive of the traditional methods. Then you apply a neural network to learn the solution for different inputs. So it to enable faster prediction. And for the data set, let me show you what's the inputs and what's outputs. So we have many different inputs. So there are three inputs. They are functions of the spatial coordinates, so including the horizontal permeability, vertical permeability, and the porosity. These are three functions. Then in addition to these three fields, we also have seven scalar inputs. For example, what's the injection rate, the temperature, initial pressure, location of foration. So given all these inputs, given all these conditions, then we can compute what's corresponding PDE solution of gas saturation and also pressure. So showing here is just one specific case. So this is the injection location, then the CO2 will go from left to right. So for this problem, we can either apply the standard network. For example, this is just a 3D problem, 2D in space, 1D in time. Then we may apply a CNN network, but in 3D, for example, 3D UNet. Or we can apply some other networks. For example, we can learn in the Fourier space, which is the method of FNO. So in this paper showing here, so they combine the 3D UNet and the 3D FNO into a single network in order to achieve a good accuracy of prediction. So this is network architecture. So in each layer, this is one Fourier layer and also one convolution layer, actually a UNet layer. However, this is too expensive of the training and also prediction. But as I mentioned, we have the another tool of MIONet. If we apply MIONet to this case, then we will have many different branch nets and a single trunk net. For the branch nets, each branch net will take a single input because we have a group of inputs as shown here. Then we have a trunk net. So the input of trunk net will be x, y, and t, all the spatial and temporal coordinates. Then the output is just a scalar, basically the solution. For example, saturation at this specific XYT. In this approach, the cost is really low. Instead of doing 3D inputs and outputs, our output is a scalar. However, by using the simple dot product merge operation, if I go to here, so all the branch nets and other electron nets, they are merged together by a simple element-wise product and sum. So this simple operation is hard to learn the detailed structure in space, as shown in this example here. So it cannot capture all these details, although the accuracy in general is okay, 5%. Then what we do, we try to combine these two approaches together in order to achieve good prediction accuracy and also network training efficiency. So this network we designed is called Fourier MIONet. So the general framework of this network is MIONet. So we have branch and a trunk. However, for the merge operation, instead of using a standard dot product, we apply a Fourier layer or a UNet or UNet layer. But compared with previous version of this standard UFNO, in this case, we only need 2D UNet and a 2D FNO because we still have a trunknet. Our trunknet will have a time T as input. Then our output is not a scalar, but it's not a 3D. It's a 2D solution of the 2D PD solution at arbitrary specific time T. So basically, we split temporal and spatial to handle them differently. So this approach can still achieve good accuracy as shown in these four examples here. So in these four examples, we have different cases of different patterns of the solution. So you can see that the R2 is 0.99, almost equal to 1. But more importantly, when we still keep the good accuracy, we can have much lower training cost. I'll show you in the second table here. So for UFNO, it has more than 33 million parameters. But for the Fourier MIONet, we only have around 3 million parameters. For the CPU memory, we can reduce from more than 100 gigabytes to 15 gigabytes. For the GPU memory, reduce from 16 gigabytes to 6 gigabytes. And the training time can be reduced from 42 hours to 12 hours. So it's much more computational efficient. And more importantly, by using this approach, we can have the prediction even for unseen time. So let me show you what I mean here by unseen time. So because we try to predict the solution for the following 30 years, but in practice, the data set we have in total of 24 snapshots in these 30 years. So what if we only train the network by using the snapshot 1, snapshot 3, snapshot 5, 7, but what we try to predict for all the snapshots? If you look at the standard performance of the UFNO, for the location with the training time, it's good accuracy. But for the location, for example, for snapshot 2, because there's no training data set for snapshot 2, then during the prediction, the accuracy would be really low. But for the Fourier MIONet, we can still maintain a good accuracy even for unseen snapshots. So it's a good generalization for unseen time. So the reason is that, so we put the time T as a trunknet input, then the network would automatically satisfy the property that it's the solution will be continuous over time. So basically it obeys the underlying physics of the continuity over time. So we can even use only 25 snapshots for training. So this will be very very useful when you try to collect the data set in our real life, because every single snapshot data collection is expensive. So this is one application in geoscience. Here, let me show you another application also in geoscience, the four waveform inversion, FWI. So in this application, we aim to infer the subsurface structure C. The C is the velocity map of the underlying subsurface structure from the seismic waveform data. Waveform data is P, pressure. So specifically, let's consider we have a 2D domain, a 2D subsurface domain. Then if we have a source in the location A, then the source would generate a wave, propagates in this domain. Then you have many different receivers placed on the surface at this top location, top surface here, then these receivers will receive the wave from the source, propagates through the subsurface. For example, for the first picture shown here, so this is the what the receiver received for the source A. So if we have source at this location, then for the receivers at the top will receive this kind of signals. So this is for a different location and over a different time. If we have source at a location B, then this is the signal received at a different receivers. Because we only have the information at the surface, we cannot do the prediction of this velocity map from a single source. So in this case, we consider we have five different sources at location A, B, C, D, E. Then the task is that we try to predict the velocity map of the subsurface from these five signals. The signal could be a clean signal, or it could be the signal plus some noise or some missing traces. And for this problem, the equation is acoustic wave equation as shown here. And for the source, so S here, we consider it's a point source. It's either in the location A or location B or location C. So it's a point source and generated by the wavelet shown in the picture here. And here the frequency F can control the shape of the wavelet. Still, we apply the network of the Fourier DeepM&Mnet, the same network architecture. So after training, this is a few different test cases. So this is ground truth. So first of all, we try to see whether our network can have the good prediction for different source locations and different frequencies of the source. The source locations and the frequencies. And this is the three different predictions for different data inputs, different frequencies and different source locations. So the accuracy is good, but here I try to emphasize the robustness of the network architecture. So during the training, our data set is clean data set, but during the testing or prediction case, we add a Gaussian noise to the input of the network. Now we're trying to see whether our network prediction can still be accurate given the noisy input. So we do not do any fine tuning or post processing. So clean data set for training, but noisy data for testing. So for our test case, we have four different patterns of the ground truth. But in this example here, I only show the prediction for the FVB pattern and the CVA pattern. So on the left, in the panel B, so this is the different levels of the noise. So you can see we have at higher and higher noise level to our input data set, to the input of the network. But for the prediction of the Fourier DeepM&Mnet, it is still accurate. It can produce the same pattern at the ground truth. However, if we compare with other networks, for example, the inversion net or velocity gain, these are two baselines for the FWI application. They are also network-based approaches. However, for these two networks, they cannot tolerate the noise in the input. So this is another prediction case for the CVA ground truth. Still, you can see, even by adding a really high noise level, you can still have good prediction compared to the ground truth. But the prediction from other networks, for the inversion net or velocity gain, is totally off. So this is one test case. And here, this is another robust test. But we can see the noise has the source has the noise. instead of the input. So which means if you consider during the prediction or testing case of the data set or the test case, the wavelet is not a perfect wavelet, but it has some noise. For example, in this picture here, it has a really high noise level. So we do not see this kind of wavelet in our training data set. But even for this case, when you apply the Fourier DeepONet, we can still have a very good prediction accuracy compared to ground truth. But again, for other networks, the accuracy is bad. Another robustness test we consider is the missing traces. So during the training, our input is always clean data. But what if during a prediction case, a prediction stage, for the input, there are many traces or many signals they are missing? For example, in this case, there are many signals they are just missing. They are a zero. So by using the Fourier DeepONet, we can still have a good accuracy. So this is the test case for the CFA velocity map and STA. So you can see our Fourier DeepONet prediction for these two cases. They are still very accurate compared to other networks. So again, so we never seen this kind of data set during the training. So they are all extrapolation. But the DeepONet or Fourier DeepONet, they are really robust against all these noise or missing traces. I have showing several examples of the performance of DeepONet or extensions of DeepONet. But in all these cases, we still need a data set, usually a large data set for training. However, in practice, it could be difficult to obtain a large high fidelity data set. Now, one idea to tackle this problem is called multi-fidelity learning. So in multi-fidelity learning, we have two data sets. One is called high fidelity data set. Another one is called low fidelity data set. So for high fidelity data set, it's high accurate, but the data set is small. But for the low fidelity, it's different. So it's low accuracy, but its data set is large. So here are two examples. So on the left, we can see the example of the aircraft design. So we can collect the data set, for example, for experiments. So this is accurate, but it's really expensive to generate a large data set. Or we can run simulations, FEM simulations. It's less accurate, but we can have a lot. So this is another example of the sea surface temperature prediction. So this is the location of the Boston Harbor. Now we try to predict the temperature in this sea surface. The data set that we have could be the measurement from all these sensors as shown by the dots here. So these are sensors in the sea surface. So it's very accurate, but it's sparse. Or we can have the measurement from the satellite. It's less accurate, but we can have a lot. So the multi-fidelity learning try to integrate the data set of different levels together to achieve a good accuracy. So we apply the idea of multi-fidelity learning into operator learning and developed a multi-fidelity DeepONet. So in multi-fidelity DeepONet, so first of all, we have one DeepONet called DeepONet low. So DeepONet low takes the inputs, for example, V or C, then generates output prediction, so GL. So because we assume we have a large data set or low fidelity, then this DeepONet low can be trained well without any problem. Then the question is, how can we have the prediction of high fidelity? So one idea is that we aim to learn the residual or correction term between low and high fidelities. So basically, we write down the G high, the high fidelity prediction is equal to the low fidelity prediction plus a correction term. Then we apply network at DeepONet high to learn this correction term. Also, in many cases, there is always a high correlation between low and high fidelities. Then we also aim to learn this correlation by using DeepONet high. So specifically, for DeepONet high, we also, in addition to the inputs of the function, like function v, we also put the low fidelity prediction g low as another input of DeepONet high. Then the DeepONet high will learn the correlation between g low and g high. So this is the final architecture and the corresponding equations. So this is one test case of the Boltzmann transport equation for nanostructured material. So this equation is not too complex, but this is not a single equation, but an equation of a system of 24,000 coupled PDEs, because we have this index mu, which is the index of the wave vector discretization in this Boltzmann transport equation. So it's a large scale PDE system. And for this case, we consider our computation domain is a square domain, but in this square domain, we have 5 by 5 small squares in this blue color. And each blue color can be a pore without a material. For example, this is one specific example. All these locations, they are pores. Then if you solve the BT equation in this geometry, this is the corresponding solution. And if you have different material with different location or pores, we have a different solution. So we aim to learn the operator G mapping from the geometry to the solution. But here we are not interested in a specific solution F mu. We are interested in the heat flux, the G mu, the J, as a weighted summation of the F mu. So also this is a complex geometry, also different training cases have different geometry, but DeepONet can be handled, can be applied without any modification because it's mesh free. So we have so first we have a low fidelity data set of size 10,000. And the accuracy is showing in the dashed line here. So you can see the mean square error compared to the high fidelity solution is almost 10 to 92. So it's really a low fidelity solution. Or if we train a DeepONet only using high fidelity solution, we can increase the data set size from 10 to a few thousand. If we have more data set, the error would decrease. But even if we have 5,000, the accuracy is still not good enough. But by integrating the low and high data sets together and using multi-fidelity DeepONet, we can have a much better accuracy. So one order of magnitude smaller than the high fidelity only, I show you in the red line here. So from this part, we can see it's really efficient by using multi-fidelity learning for small data sets. Okay, I have showed many good examples of machine learning, or especially DeepONet. However, all these examples, or actually all the most machine learning models, they are limited to interpolation. But in practice, we always test extrapolation. So the robustness test I showed before for the FWI application is extrapolation, but it's only adding nuances. It's not in practice, we have extrapolation more than that. Then how can we handle the extrapolation? So this is the last part of my talk. Still, we consider the extrapolation in the operator learning setup. So we try to learn an operator G with input U, input is V, output is U. If you consider V is sampled from a space of Gaussian random field, with mean zero function and covariance kernel KL. For example, it could be a squared exponential or radial base function kernel showing here. In this kernel, there is a parameter L. So if L is large, let's say 1.0, then the functions in this space, they are all smooth and showing in this plot. If L is small, then the functions would become more oscillated and fluctuated. So what if we train a network by using all the functions in this space? They are smooth functions. But what if we try to predict for the functions with the correlation length equal to 0.1? Then intuitively, the error must be large, not because it's extrapolation. We have never seen this kind of complex function input during the training. So let me show you two specific examples of the extrapolation in this operator learning setup. So on the left, we have a simple ODE, du dx equal to v. We aim to learn the G mapping from V, the right-hand side of the ODE, to the solution of the ODE. Then we generate different training data set and different testing data set. So the x-axis here in this plot is the correlation length for training, and the y-axis here is correlation length for testing. Then in this plot, in the diagonal line, so the training and the testing spaces, they are the same space, the same correlation length. So L train equal to L test. So this is interpolation. And we know that we can do well for the interpolation. And let's look at the upper triangle of this domain. So in this domain, the correlation length for training is smaller than the correlation length for testing. So in this case, it belongs to extrapolation. However, if you look at the error here, so the color is the error, we can still have a small error. So in this case, we call this as extrapolation minus. So it's extrapolation, but it's still a small error. But for the Bayesian triangle of this domain, so in this case, the correlation length for training is larger than the correlation for testing. So which means we train the network using smooth functions and test using non-smooth functions. So in this case, we have a large error. So this is the extrapolation we aim to address, extrapolation plus. Oh, by the way, for the extrapolation minus, so in this case, it means we train the network using complex functions, but a test using smooth functions, so the network can handle it. The same phenomena we have observed in many other examples, for example, differential regression equation and many more. Okay, we aim to address this issue of extrapolation plus. But before we design the algorithm, so in the first step, let's try to quantify the complexity of extrapolation. So if we still we have two spaces, two Gaussian random fields, F1 space and F2 space. So we try to measure the distance between these two spaces. So one way to measure this is by using W2 metric, as shown in the equation here. What I try to show is that the W2 metric cannot be only used to measure the distance between two spaces. It can also be used to quantify or to indicate the complexity of extrapolation. Again, for the ODE example, we have the testing and for different space of compared to the training. And in this plot, so the x-axis is the W2 distance between the training space and testing space. The y-axis is the extrapolation error. So you can see in the log-log scale, the extrapolation error has a linear scaling versus W2 distance. So which means we can use W2 distance to infer or to indicate how the complexity of the extrapolation for a new input. Then based on this, we design this framework or flowchart for reliable extrapolation. So first step is still we have, let's assume we have a pre-trained DeepM&Mnet or a predefined data set. Okay, this network is pre-trained. Then for a new input function V, we first apply our pre-trained DeepM&Mnet do the prediction, let's say our prediction U tilde. Then we can quantify whether this U tilde or whether this input function V belongs to interpolation or extrapolation minus or extrapolation plus. If it's interpolation or extrapolation minus, then we know we can have a good accuracy by directly returning the prediction of U tilde. If extrapolation minus a plus, then the U tilde would have a large error. Then we have to improve or correct U tilde, but in order to do this, we require some additional information. So the additional information could be some physics or some new data set. So the physics here, usually I refer is the governing equations. So if we have the governing equation, then we can do the fine tuning of the pre-trained DeepM&Mnet in order to improve the accuracy. If it's a new data set, first of all, the new data set definitely is small. Right? If we have already a large data set for new space, then we can directly train a DeepM&Mnet for that. So but we assume we only have a small data set for new cases, then we can still do fine tuning by using the new sparse data set. Or we can also apply the multifidelity idea I have discussed. So our prediction U tilde, although it's less accurate, but we can have U tilde for arbitrary input at arbitrary location. And the new data set is small but is accurate, which is can be viewed as high fidelity. Then we apply multiphysics learning to integrate these two. So in our paper, we have developed many different versions of how do we do the fine tuning, how we perform the multiphysics learning. So I will not discuss here. There are many different approaches. But let's look at one example of this global climate change. So this is a data set of the daily surface air temperature Tx and also pressure Px from the years 1950 to 2021. And this is one example of the temperature and the pressure of the Earth's surface on the date January 1st, 2021. And we aim to learn the operator G mapping from the temperature to the pressure. However, we only train our DeepM&Mnet using the data set from 1950 to 1955, which is the first 5 years for training. Then we try to do the prediction for all the remaining years. And in the plot here, you can see for later years, we will have a larger extrapolation error because we have a global climate change. The pattern or the correlation between temperature and pH and the pressure, they are not fixed. They change over time. Okay, then in order to improve the prediction accuracy, let's say for this date, January 1st, 2021, let's consider we have the extra data set at 100 weather locations. I show you all the by the black dots here. So we have 100 sparse measurements on the Earth's surface. Then by using this extra measurement, we can improve the accuracy of our prediction. So this is the final error. In total, of all the errors is below 0.7%. Okay, this is the what I try to present today. So basically, we have developed a family of DeepM&Mnets, standard DeepM&Mnet, MIONet, POD-DeepONet, or Fourier DeepM&Mnet, and many different other versions. And we have applied our network to many different applications, multiphysics, multiscale applications. I didn't present all of them, but you can find some references here and also in our website. So on the last page, let me briefly introduce our software called DeepSD. So this is open source software for scientific machine learning and also physics informed learning. It implements many different methods, for example, all the DeepNets, all different versions I presented today, and also physics informed networks and some other networks. Nowadays, we have more than 50 contributors around the world adding frequently contributing new features and a new code to the library, and it's in GitHub. Yeah, feel free to use the library or modify the library to implement a new method. With that, thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for the wonderful talk, Liu. So now we'll have the Q&A section. Oh, Henry asked in the early stage. So he asked, does the theory talking about how many layer or parameters we need to use to successfully approximate the operator?
Yeah, that's a good question. So in the theory here, and also in the second theory I showed here, it's only a theory of the universal approximation. So which means it guarantees there exists a network that's good enough, but it does not provide us more information, for example, what the network size should be. But in our another paper, I list in the end, in this paper, we did more analysis of the network size. For example, if we try to achieve epsilon error, what the network size should be. If you're interested, I think you can refer to this paper. However, this paper still has a limitation. We only consider a very specific few PDEs, but for more complex PDEs, the downside is still unknown.
Okay. So Raypen asks, what are the branch and the trunk nets inputs respectively for the PDE examples like the Darcy and the affection diffusion problems?
Yes. So for the network showing here, for the trunk net, the inputs is the coordinates, it's the same as pings. So for example, the spatial coordinate, X, Y, Z, the temporal coordinate, and the T. For the branch net, the input is the specific condition of the PDE you try to solve. For example, in this case, for the trunk net, the input is boundary condition. Then for other cases, for example, in this advection diffusion case, the input is a diffusion coefficient dx, and also initial condition u0x.
See, so I don't see any more questions. Maybe I can ask one more about the extrapolation part. So on page 39. So I see you use this additional information to correct the original DeepNet, pre-trained DeepNet output. So you use kind of like physics and new data. So what kind of physics are you, assuming like in the complicated example that you show the climate change. So are you assuming full physics exactly? You know everything about the PDEs and everything about the domain.
Okay, that's a good question. So in our paper, what we did is we assume we know the PDEs. But for this example, we do not know the physics. So we only test the case of neural data set because the physics is too complex, it's unknown.
I see.
Yeah, but in our other cases, in our paper, we showed if we know the physics, for example, it's non-resource equation, and then we can apply it for fine tuning.
I see. So if there are no more questions, let's thank Liu again for sharing his excellent research with us.
Thank you.